thank you for joining us today. Let's face it, like we just talked about it, AI is around us everywhere, right? From recommending the next TV series that we'll binge watch, to maybe even writing these opening comments, though I cannot deny or confirm that. But before the robots take over our jobs, and they promise to be nice about it, let's learn how this technology is actually affecting the banking sector. And our esteemed panelists here are here to separate the hype from reality. So get ready for some insightful conversations and hopefully robot-free ones. So Wendy, I joined BI in 2015, and that coincidentally was the year when AI was known, that it was a landmark year for AI. Cloud computing infrastructure became vastly more powerful and more affordable. There was a lot more data being created. A lot of qualitative factors were now quantifiable by the way we could capture them into data pieces, and software became cheaper. Yet back in the day, the biggest use cases that we saw within banks for AI were chatbots. Mm-hmm. And then over the years, we've seen a lot more citations for AI being used in fraud detection and prevention, in credit underwriting. Algorithmic trading has become like more talked about. And then wealth managers, for the lack of right or wrong, we're talking about robo-advisory and hybrid advice. What part of your business is AI really supercharging, and what are the use cases that you've seen and found to be helpful?
So for now, so Piermont is commercial bank only, so we don't have retail business. So where we have seen the most impact internally from a use case standpoint has been fraud detection, especially in the sense of BSA AML, meaning transaction monitoring, identifying suspicious activities. And that's been also most aligned, frankly, from a regulatory desire standpoint and framework. So we thought that's the easiest, that's the most impactful way to start, especially in working with the regulators, and we'll talk more about that later. Getting them also comfortable and see the positive impact of using AI. So that's where we've been spending most of the time. When Piermont was built from scratch, like literally a blank slate back in 2018, 2019. So when we were building these technology stacks, we actually first and foremost was thinking of using more AI technology to do acquisition at the front end. And then very quickly realizing that some of the inherent bias that potentially can present in the data sets and stuff, to introduce that as the first step out the gate for a commercial bank, it was just not the most wise thing from a risk management standpoint. So that's where we've been using it.
Yeah. That's interesting. Manav, how about you? Like, where have you seen the most bang for the buck for your AI projects?
Yeah, and Regions is a regional bank in 16 states, about 21,000 associates. And what we've focused on is, well, let me first start by separating out traditional AI, which includes machine learning and natural language processing, from generative AI. So our focus has been more on the traditional AI, and the use cases are numerous. We've built data products that help our bankers really understand their customers in the moment and recommend what kind of conversations to have with them, minimize the risk around the transaction, including fraud, and then really enable a very successful positive customer experience. So just as an example, we built out a data product called RClick, which our commercial bankers use every day. And they, before every customer interaction, it gives them a rich view of what their customers are doing at that moment, and what kind of product to recommend to them, what kind of financial risk may be emerging with a particular customer, what kind of retention risk might be emerging, pricing, optimization, finding new prospects. So just as an example, this is the kind of thing that we do on a day-to-day basis.
Understood. We promised to sift hype from reality. So not sure if you followed the controversy around Amazon's just walkout technology. The company claimed that allowed customers to just bypass the traditional checkout. As an achievement powered by entirely computer vision. The controversy was that the technology was in fact 1,000 people sitting in India and who review what you pick and walk out of the stores with. There appears to be this imminent hype and this pressure around deploying AI or claiming to deploy AI across any and every problem that you can find. In your view, Manav, what is the most overappreciated or overhyped era of a problem that you could solve with regular analytics, but people are trying to solve with AI?
Yeah. And I tell my team every day that, you know, use the Occam's razor, which is find the simplest solution to a problem. You don't have to, you know, go with generative AI to solve a problem which maybe just a simple computation may result in a good solution. You see that all over the place, and it's partly people like us who are, you know, techies at heart. They're excited about new ideas and new technologies and want to bring this hammer to every nail that they can find. As an example, another product that we've built out is called Our Voice, and this is a voice of the customer product. It really looks at what customers are saying to us and about us in different forums, and we were able to use a transformer model, a simple transformer model that allowed us to really find trends which helped our bankers understand what they needed to react to, what they need to leave out. We didn't have to go to an LLM and try and do that for our banks.
Yeah, and that's possible because you're not going out in the market to look for funding, Manav. That's true. Telling me that. Wendy, developing and maintaining AI infrastructure can be very expensive, yeah. Especially for smaller firms, right?
Yeah.
How do you think about the cost-benefit analysis of deploying AI for different projects?
Yeah, so I think I'll answer your question in a different way. For us, has been about breaking it down to digestible phases. Because with the AI, what we learned early on is the recalibration is really important. So monitoring for effectiveness, and then recalibrate is so critical. So, and also from an internal stakeholder buying standpoint, also it's another reason why it's better to chop it down to more digestible phases to make sure that everybody is on the same page, senior management and the board, so that funding is there, right? And then enforcement is there in terms of the rollout and the training. So for all those reasons, right, we have been taking the approach of making sure that every phase, it has a measurable ROI. So it's measurable value add versus always gunning for transformative, some type of transformation. It, at least for us, it, especially for a smaller shop, that's not what we are gunning for, right? It's making sure that everything we do has a very practical return on what we implement.
So I think that kind of applies to the broader macro environment that we are in as well, right? Like cost of funding has gone up. Yeah. There's a lot more rationality that is coming back to what is the ROI of these projects, and it's back to basics, like what is the value that it's delivering. So even as AI promises a lot of potential, it effectively comes with its own set of hurdles, and the biggest ones that we've heard are around data challenges and regulations. Mm-hmm. So let's start with you, Manav. One of the most important considerations is data. What sort of challenges have you seen, be it around security risks and data breaches, or around data quality and integration that you have seen, and what are some of the solutions that you've kind of come up with?
Yeah, so you've outlined the two big issues that you have to be concerned about. So one is that the quality of the data going into your AI has to be pristine. Without that, the quality of the output suffer. So we've taken a number of measures around trying to ensure data quality. So we look at three different aspects of data that goes into any consumption, which includes AI. But the first one is the data is adequately cataloged. It's got metadata associated with every critical data element, and so we've got a tool around that. The second one is that we've got rich lineage for each of the critical data elements that go into the data consumption endpoints that include AI. And so we've got a tool that lays out the lineage, and then you're able to then look at each of the points that the data is being touched on and what controls you have around that. And finally, you have a data quality engine, which then has rules associated with the quality of the data. So whenever an element gets entered in, which is outside the range or anything like that, there are alerts that are fired. The second aspect is the security of it, and our chief information security officer does a tremendous job in putting the controls around customer data particularly. And even though we're taking our first steps into using the cloud, et cetera, the same kind of controlling environment exists to protect customer data from leaving the bank. So,
yes, I think third-party LLMs can unintentionally reveal sensitive information, especially when it's presented with prompts or instructions. So having that foundational layer of data infrastructure and security, as Matt also pointed out, those are like the foundational steps before embarking on any AI journey. Another thing that we've discussed is around RAG's approach to kind of prevent and secure the information that your LLMs are kind of able to spit out. Coming to regulatory hurdles, Wendy, What are some of the considerations that you have to keep in mind while using LLMs? And you've had some experience with that too with the regulators.
Yeah. So I think it really does vary in terms of where you are implementing and digesting AI. So in the world of wealth management, where your products wealth management only. But I think if your product is being delivered to the consumer versus corporate clients, commercial clients, you have different sets of regulations that are consumer protection driven, right? So it is really important that everything, you know, what I just said is that overlay that in terms of the risk framework, right? Every bank has a enterprise risk management risk assessment, and that's approved by the board. So as you think about AI, you really got to integrate and incorporate into your overall enterprise risk management assessment. And then from that, you need to make sure that whatever you are implementing, it truly reflects that in the procedures and the process and the delivery of your products, if there's any AI embedment in there. So. And without communicating that clearly to the regulators during examination and audit, I can guarantee you criticism. How's that? At the very minimum.
And actually, if I may just add to that, so what we've done at Regions is created an integrated AI risk framework. This is a team that was from different parts of the bank, so included legal. It was led by my team, but then included legal, procurement, InfoSec, the software development teams, and so really came up with that overall framework and then the underlying policy and standard that anyone who wants to use AI at the bank has to follow. And you know, if they deviate from that, there are mechanisms to control against that.
So that was risk management and regulations, but how about ethical considerations? So I want to give an example there. Cookie maker and bakery franchise chain Crumble is being sued over sharing customer financial information with their payment processor, Stripe. Crumble had incorporated Stripe's wiretaps in their website, allowing the processor to record customers' mouse movements, clicks, keystrokes, IP address, physical location, and financial information. And even as Crumble gave this information to Stripe with a very noble goal, it wanted to protect itself from fraudulent transactions, it really is a very fine balance. Where do you draw the line? So any thoughts around that, Manav? Like, how do we promote this amazing set of services securely to your clients while still not invading privacy to that extent?
Interesting. So cookies of two different kinds came together in that situation. Crumble, which my daughter loves, by the way. In terms of ethical AI, so our risk framework is based on a set of ethical principles, and they go back to the governing principles at Regions, and which includes do the right thing, focus on your customer, and those are incorporated into how we look at AI as well, as we look at all technologies. So what we've then gone and done is built on top of that, and again, we've brought in tools that help us look at how we are monitoring the performance of our models so that they're not incorporating variables that may end up with disparate impact to a particular demographic or specific customers. We've got our risk framework, which most banks have, all banks have, first line of defense, second line of defense, third line of defense. The second line of defense does an independent review of all of our models. Compliance looks at all the how those models are built and what their performance is going to be like. And then our audit function then audits each of those models as well. So there are lots of governing structures that we've put in place that point back to those core ethical principles that are part of our framework.
If I may add, I think even if you're not in the banking sector, meaning being highly regulated, model validation and establishing what is the most appropriate interval that you should conduct model validation is really critical. And whether it's really actually delivering the performance that you're looking for, in addition to from a managing risk standpoint, right?
Yep.
Just keep monitoring and validating.
So don't wait for the regulators to come and tell you what's the right thing to do. Preempt that. That's probably the bigger takeaway. Last question for you, Wendy. So we were talking about regulations and talk about I'm not going to quote Jamie Dimon here, but talk about the level playing field.
Yeah.
You are competing with the likes of Apple. By the way, I don't know if you followed the announcement. They promoted new launches around tap to cash. Mm-hmm. When they announced pay later, a lot of banks and fintechs kind of stocks drop. How do you fight that battle, or how do you defend versus the big tech against that battle?
Sure. So I've always told my team that we focus on doing what we know how to do the best. And what we do know is banking products. And we never walk around, even though we're the first true, completely tech-enabled banks built, but we don't walk around and pretend to be a software company, to be a technology company. That's really important. So if you flip that, right? Apple, what do they focus on? What are they typically excelled in, right? So is banking knowledge, especially understanding regulation, that's where we have the competitive advantage, is that knowing how to tie it back to risk. It's not the most glamorous, exciting part, but it's critically important to ensure that as we try to sort of trailblaze in this world, in this particular area, that we don't actually end up getting into larger trouble than unintended consequences. How's that? So that's why I would say that understanding the banking products, understanding the regulation around it, and the proper risk framework is the bank's competitive advantage.
And if I may just add to that, I think the real, I think you have to look at every possible competitor that may come into your space. But at the end of the day, we've built a relationship with our customers, mm-hmm. and we've got bankers that are local that understand the customers and the domain, and we empower them with data and technology to help them serve the customers. Yeah. That's how you can compete against any of the possible competitors.